Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. After reading this e-content, student naturally have some concept about Dryden as a critic and something about essay on dramatic poesy. And then the first Critias has put some of the basic views about the favor of the ancient dramas. But now way in which Eugenius has favored the modern dramas, sir, I think if you throw some more light with a Eugenius point of view, it would be better for the students.
Right. It's all in a sequence. Meaning, Dryden is doing in his own age what Philip Sidney in the earlier era was doing. Justify the solid native English tradition of literature too, while not disrespecting the ancient's contribution, it was all coming off the ongoing discourses and debates within the English tradition. Do we need to go on our own, or do we need to look back to the ancients only for dicta? Do we need only to follow them, or can we build something separately, or are we subordinate to them, or do we revolt against them? These are some of the unsolved dilemmas.
Yes, yes.
That's why the four interlocutors.
Yes, yes, yes.
And the argument is initiated by Critias.
Yeah.
Critias puts in a simple package that all that the ancients did were good. The simple business is to follow them. That is the most naive argument on the part of the practitioners of classicism. In fact, some of the neoclassicists were proposing that.
Yes.
But the dilemmatical content is first brought into the pan by Eugenius. Eugenius's position is, you know, not free of tension. He is trying to make both poles together. He says, tries to stay within the neoclassical boundary. He puts forth his arguments while not stashing aside the classical bindings.
Yes.
He says, so that's how his arguments are moulded in a particular capacity. He says, the ancients wrote certain rules.
Yeah.
But look, the ancients didn't always themselves, you know, pay 100% obedience to their own fangled three unities or unity of action, etc. The tragedians were separate from the comedians, and they did not paint certain scenes of emotion like love emotions. While saying this thing, Eugenius unconsciously, Dryden is playing on it,
yeah.
Dryden makes Eugenius put in an argument which comes to be a defense of the Elizabethans. Eugenius perhaps does not mean it to be particularly of the Elizabethans. In trying to save the native practice, and Eugenius is not blind to the good things in the Elizabethans. Though himself, he is pro-classicist, he honors the classicist models. He says, no, the moderns have been only following them. We may or may not agree with him. By saying the moderns, he is, I feel, including the Elizabethans and the neoclassical English Augustans.
Yes, yes.
So unknowingly,
yeah,
he is walking into a position where he is holding a brief for the English dramatists.
Yes.
And he is justifying imagination, love scenes. He refers to Shakespeare and Fletcher. And he says, our players, drama writers are better because the same person can roam between tragedy and comedy, etc., etc., etc. But what he still maintains is that as if everything is taking place in conformity to the spirit of the classical references.
Yes, sir.
So there is a limitation in Eugenius's argument, which will be corrected ultimately in Neander's defense.
Yes, right. In a way, the Dryden's entire plan, after Eugenius, Lycidius come and favor French drama, this is also very, very interesting. So, sir, will you throw some more light with Lycidius' argument?
Right. What Dryden is doing is putting in the pan all the current debates that were raging in that day.
Yes.
And the Tory Whig positions are also come on to play. The Tories are very conservative.
Yeah.
So naturally, though not 100% at par, the Toryism is rather conducive to and congenial with the classicism bent, bias. And the Whiggery, meaning believing in liberal things, to be liberal, to be asking for more power and more freedom, etc., that is a radical liberal side. And Shakespeare and Webster, they were practicing liberal freedoms. While talking of discipline, decorum, and need for going back to the classicists, in actual terms, dramatists find, and also the theoreticians find, that it is after all not very bad to try new ways or to be asking for some freedom. So, the people who find who are conservative, they bring in another objection. Look, you are becoming exceptional. You English writers are walking off the main road. Look at the French.
Yeah.
They have been producing nice plays within the classical precincts. That's why Lycidas is representing that part of the neoclassical critical community who are all for French models, because they are, as it were, they are paying up better service, better obedience to the classical references. This part also needs to be solved. Whether the French people are really better and whether they are really living up closer to the classical model. And vis-a-vis, whether the English dramatists in their own ways are living up closer or not closer to the classical model, or whether by departing from the classical model they have been doing any offense.
Yes.
That's why Lycidas's argument also is very much taking its, is falling in place. After the classical modern dilemma,
yeah,
the French neoclassicist application vis-a-vis the English practice is also becoming very appropriate. All these wires will be later on synthesized in Neander's reference.
Yes, and can we find any kind of historical reference with the restoration of Charles II? He restored from France to England, and it was the same time.
This leads us into wider, socio-political issues. Yes, definitely the Whig flavors and the Tory flavors, the Royalists and the dissenters. But I think we can serve the students with the aids of hyperlinks.
Yeah, yes, sir.
In the module.
Yes, sir.
To study how the Fletcher says the dispositions of these dramatists as persons living in England.
Yes.
In the then England, are becoming influenced by the political air and ambience of the day.
Exactly. Okay. Thank you very much, sir.